a very warm welcome to King's College Chapel. We gather today to remember and celebrate a remarkable gentleman, Professor John Mallard. We gather fittingly in this chapel as it was a special place for John and his wife, Fiona. Fiona having grown up in Aberdeen, and John attending many a service here during his time with the University of Aberdeen. We come together as a diverse group of people, representing the many different places, aspects, and traits of John's life, and the many ways in which he touched all of our lives. I never knew Professor Mallard, but it has been an honor to read and hear about his life and the inspiring man that he was. Some of you will have known John professionally, and we will hear about the incredible and inspirational career that he had and the unbelievable impact his research, tenacity, and vision has had and continues to have throughout the world today, a very real legacy that has given each and every single one of us in the MRI scanner. We will also hear about the man who was John Mallard, a much-loved son, husband, father, grandfather, friend, and so much more, a true gentleman whose courage and creativity, kindness, and deep love of family are sorely missed. During our time together, all the music and readings have special meaning to both John and his family. In a moment, we will sing one of his favorite hymns, a hymn that's about the unpredictability of life's journey. And it's appropriate that we sing it today as we remember the life of a man who was never deterred from traveling the hard road and showed courage in adversity. Please stand with me as we sing Who Would True Valor See?
Thank you.
Please do have a seat. Let's pray together. Let's pray. God of life and light and hope, we thank you that your compassion and love surrounds each of us. We gather with hearts that are heavy with the sadness of loss, but also hearts full of gratitude and thanks as we remember and celebrate the life of Professor John Mallard. God of compassion, may you comfort those of us who feel the weight of grief. Strengthen us with a light of your peace, and may we know your ever unconditional, loving presence with us. Bless especially John and Catriona and all those who loved John the most, a much loved husband, father, grandfather, friend, and colleague. We thank you that you make us in love and you make us for love. And you have shown us that the grave is not the end, for your love holds us through all things and never ends. Amen. Catriona is going to come and share.
It is wonderful to have this opportunity today to remember Dad and to acknowledge the huge contribution he made to the world of medical imaging. Thank you to everyone from the university who has worked so hard to make this happen, in particular Lottie Rogers. Thank you to Reverend Mary Lee Anderson and her team for having us here in your beautiful chapel. It is especially emotional being here in King's, as it is 30 years, almost to the day, that Dad walked me down this aisle at our wedding. Thank you for the wonderful music directed today by Alan Quinn. And thank you to Professor Peter Sharp and to Professor Alison Murray for kindly making tributes. Thank you, everyone, for being with us today, both here in the chapel and those watching online. Colleagues, relatives, and friends of Mum and Dad, it is deeply appreciated. We look forward to seeing those present later in Elphiston Hall after the service. Dad was a truly inspirational man. He was a pioneer, a creative thinker, and a determined visionary. Dad believed in the importance of the team, of collaboration between all disciplines, and indeed across the world, to achieve the goal of improving patient care. He believed in passing this on to the next generations and to lead them to make the next steps. His colleagues who wrote kind condolence messages described how Dad had a boyish enthusiasm for science, a sense of fun, and a slightly mischievous sparkle in the eye when proposing an adventurous line of research. Dad was gentle and kind. The many lovely notes of condolence to our family repeatedly described him as a true gentleman. He had an interest in everyone and their story. He was deeply loved as a son, husband, son-in-law, father, grandfather, and friend. Dad remembered fondly the people who helped him along the way and influenced his life. He was an only child born in Kingsthorpe, Northampton, in 1927. He loved to tell of his grandfather, who had been the first park keeper of Northampton's Abington Park, when it was donated to the borough. Dad's father was born in the cottage in the grounds and met his wife-to-be when they moved to Bedford Park. Dad's father had been gassed and temporarily blinded in World War I, and his uncle Bill injured in Gallipoli. This had a deep effect on Dad growing up. However, he described a happy childhood and always spoke so very fondly of his parents. His father became a manager for Perks, a local chain of grocers. Then, bravely during the post-war recession, his parents set up a grocer's shop on their own in Ruskin Road, Northampton, living above the shop. The experience there always stayed with Dad, working long, hard hours, helping to count the ration coupons, weighing up and packing butter and flour rations, and making deliveries on his bicycle with the basket in front. Dad used to joke that using the bacon slicer in the shop influenced his choice of career of creating diagnostic image slices of patients in scanners. As a child, Dad spent hours with his Meccano set, saving up to buy more pieces and constructing a crane system up the staircase. His mother sounded very patient. Dad was profoundly deaf from an early age. This personal battle gave him great determination and strong purpose. His mother went out of her way to make sure that his education did not suffer, asking the school teachers to sit him at the front. There were no hearing aids when he was young, and he lip-read more than anyone realized. Despite his deafness, however, he was a wonderful lecturer and public speaker, and Dad always loved music. His family were very proud when he was awarded a place at Northampton Grammar School. Dad went to Nottingham University, and he never forgot the small but vitally important grant from Northampton Borough that helped him to be there. He went with the intention to study biology. However, on matriculation day, it was the physics lecturer that inspired Dad, and he could hear him better. So Dad chose to study physics. It was a very proud day when his parents were able to attend his graduation. Due to Dad's deafness, he was advised not to pursue a career in university teaching. And that is how Dad went into what was then called hospital physics. Here began his interest in the diagnosis and treatment of disease, always with the aim to help people. He spent 2 years at the Liverpool Radium Institute developing thyroid gland imaging. There is a lovely black and white photograph of a dapper young scientist in a white coat holding a slide rule. Those are the days before computers. He moved to London to become the Deputy Director of Medical Physics at Hammersmith Hospital. It was there that he met Fiona Mackenzie Murdoch-Lawrence, a beautiful, fiery, red-headed Aberdonian who was working as a medical secretary there. The beginning of a partnership of eternal love, friendship, and support. Fiona's mother, on first meeting Dad, concluded that he was very nice for an Englishman. They were married in 1958 at Rubislaw Church in Aberdeen, the beginning of what Dad described as 62 blissfully happy years. John and I were born in Hammersmith Hospital. And then in 1965, Dad was delighted to be offered the first chair in medical physics at the University of Aberdeen, the home city of his beloved Fiona, and the city he became so fond of. This was tinged with sadness, as Mum had just lost her mother. Dad's vision led to the pioneering Aberdeen Medical Physics team, a team that became his lifelong friends. He had an overwhelming pride for their groundbreaking work, especially how MRI revolutionized the management of multiple sclerosis, a disease which his dear cousin David had suffered from. Mum was always there, Dad's tower of strength. They were a devoted couple. They loved to be together, go to the Medkai dinner dances, His Majesty's Theatre and the music hall, entertain friends and neighbours at home, and travel together. Mum always made visitors welcome, even hosting the first Hospital Physics Association meeting reception in our home, when several busloads of delegates arrived at the front door at Anderson Drive for tea, sandwiches, and shortbread. Mum and Dad deeply appreciated the tremendous local public support which was shown to their fundraising campaign to acquire a cyclotron second-hand from Australia. Home life was so important to Dad. We have so many happy memories. Dad would frequently travel to London for meetings to raise research funding. We would pick him up at Aberdeen Airport. At the time, the airport was a single porter cabin, and see him coming down the stairs of the small plane, carrying a box of cream cakes and a bag of children's books from W.H. Smith. I never knew how he managed to not buy us the same book twice. Picnics were frequent in Deeside with flasks of tea and Mum's salmon sandwiches. Dad always had his trusty Swiss Army knife in his pocket to cut out an interesting article from the paper. Dad had a real sense of humour, and we could laugh until the tears rolled down our cheeks. He loved his grandchildren and followed their progress keenly. He was very proud and supportive. Retirement together with Mum was very happy and had some very special moments. They shared a truly magnificent day with all the family in 2004, when Dad was granted the freedom of the city of Aberdeen. It was an extremely personal and deeply cherished honour from his adoptive city. We are very grateful to Fiona Kennedy for singing today. We remember you singing so beautifully at the Freedom Evening Celebrations in the Beach Ballroom. Dad wished that he could have shared with his parents the very special moment of receiving his OBE in 1992. And then, in 2018, the tremendous honour of being granted the freedom of his birthplace, Northampton. It was a very happy day in Northampton, especially as he was able to reunite with friends and relatives. There were very happy celebrations for their 60th wedding anniversary. Dad had donated the medals and awards he had received over his career to the Aberdeen Med-Chi Society, and he was delighted to hear that they were to be displayed in the Sutty building. Mum and Dad wanted them to be a reminder of the wonderful work carried out in Aberdeen. Dad remained interested in scientific newsletters and history books. He had the pleasure of joining his international colleagues on Zoom and was so delighted to see the progress of medical physics across the world, progressed by the organizations he had helped to develop. We lost our wonderful mum in February 2020, and Dad deeply felt the loss of his beloved Fiona. As you know, we lost our lovely Dad in February 2021 at the age of 94. We miss you both. I recently went to see the exhibition at the Provost Skene's House here in Aberdeen, which celebrates pioneering people of Aberdeen who have helped shape the city and transform the world. There is a lovely exhibit there about the development of MRI in Aberdeen. It was a very emotional moment when I read the words that Dad had written for the display, only so very recently. They show his strength of character and sense of humour. It seems fitting to end with his words. Persevere in your endeavours to the end. Success or failure, ignore those, even those powerful people who say it won't work. And there will always be plenty of those. Thank you. Faith.
A few weeks ago, I was lecturing my teenage granddaughter on the need to decide what career she might follow. Now, one reflection that was rather hypocritical of me is back in 1969, when I just completed my degree in physics, I still had no idea of what I should do next. My future was decided by a phone call from a certain Professor John Mallard, suggesting that I might like to travel up to Aberdeen to see if I was interested in taking a research studentship in medical physics. Now, my knowledge of Aberdeen was limited to the fact that it appeared to be a long way from anywhere else. But this Professor Mallard was very persuasive, and as my expenses would be covered, I decided to go and see him. My first impression was of a person who was absolutely dedicated to medical physics, firmly believing of the good it could do for patients, and very driven to following the vision that he had for its future. While the department was small, I was left with a strong impression that under his guidance it would grow, and that I was being offered the opportunity to be in at the start of something exciting. The rest is history, and 23 years later, I would have the privilege of succeeding him in the chair of medical physics. Now, John had moved to Aberdeen from London, where he'd worked at the Hammersmith Hospital and then at St. Thomas's. The University of Aberdeen had had the foresight to set up the first chair of medical physics in Scotland. John was married to Fiona, who came from Aberdeen, but he said that he was more enthusiastic about moving to Aberdeen than Fiona was. I was not disappointed in my initial impression. Working with John was exhilarating, but also challenging. John never bought into the idea of using emails, and instead one would receive handwritten paper notes. But he had a device which made a copy of these notes, so that when you next met him, he would have these copies spread out in front of him. Now, as mentioned by Dr. Oakley, John was hard of hearing, and while that didn't seem to hold him up in any way, I did note that whenever I appeared to be winning an argument, his hearing aid would suddenly need to have its batteries changed. On other occasions, you would find that after he'd gone home for lunch and discussed the issue with his wife, then he would return to the fray full of new ideas as to why I was wrong and he was right. And he was never short of ideas. He often said that his interest in medical image was inspired by watching the bacon slicer in his father's shop produce slices from a joint of meat. Surely image slices of the human body would give more diagnostic information than the 2D planar images produced by X-ray machines. So started his quest to produce 3D medical images. Inevitably, there was always a shortage of money to put John's ideas into practice, but he never threw any equipment away, and instead it would be adapted to help him realize his next device. In fact, he produced his first 3D medical images by mounting an old radioisotope camera on a rotating stand that had previously been used for a radiotherapy machine. And these 3D images were produced several years before the first 3D images using X-ray CT. In his inaugural lecture, given in 1965, he set out his vision for what turned out to be perhaps his two major contributions to healthcare, not just in Scotland, but worldwide. The first was his view that a technique known as positron emission tomography would become an important imaging technique in routine use in the health service. The other, although not fully worked out in his mind at that time, was magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. I'll leave it to Professor Murray in the next talk to discuss the clinical implications of these ideas that John had, but how he achieved them nicely demonstrates his character and why he was so successful. Positron emission tomography, or PET for short, involves 3D imaging of radioactive labeled pharmaceuticals to show the body's biochemistry. For example, administering a radioactive version of glucose might show the presence of cancer, as many tumors avidly take up the sugar to maintain their high rate of metabolism. However, one requires not only a specialized camera to image the radioactivity, but also a particle accelerator known as a cyclotron to produce the radiopharmaceutical. Now, this is a very complicated and expensive piece of equipment, of which at that time there was only one in the UK, at John's Old Hospital in London. Not surprisingly, the NHS declined to assist with buying one, so John took the matters into his own hands. His first attempt involved purchasing for a nominal sum a second-hand cyclotron. The slight problem was that it was in Australia. A shipping company was persuaded to bring it to the UK, and eventually it arrived in pieces in Aberdeen. For a variety of reasons, that machine was never fully reassembled, but instead, John found out that a research project in Edinburgh that was exploring the potential of using a cyclotron to treat cancer was finishing. He managed to persuade the Medical Research Council to let him have the now redundant cyclotron. And he put together a team under Dr. Noel Evans, who dismantled it and then reassembled it in what had been old farm buildings near Woodend Hospital, which John had purchased in 1976 following a public appeal. He also obtained a second-hand PET imager, and with these he set up the second PET centre in the UK. Now, thanks to support from both the university and NHS Grampian, a new PET centre was set up on the ARI site in 1998, although I had to promise the chief executive of ARI at that time that we would not use it to develop a clinical service. I was very pleased when the university agreed that the new centre should be named after John. John's vision of PET as a routine clinical diagnostic tool eventually happened, albeit in 2003, 11 years after John had retired, when the NHS in Scotland finally realised the clinical value of PET and committed £5 million to developing a clinical service in Scotland. Because of John's foresight, Aberdeen was the first centre to perform a PET scan for the new Scottish service on the 26th of March 2006. Since then, the clinical service has been available in all major centres in Scotland. Now to MRI. John had published a paper in Nature in 1964 showing how electron spin resonance, ESR, could differentiate between normal and malignant tissue. This technique produced images using information from electrons circulating the nucleus of the atom. But unfortunately, it didn't prove feasible as an imaging technique at that time. In 1971, Raymond Damadian in the States used nuclear magnetic resonance, NMR signals, that takes information from the atomic nucleus itself rather than the electrons to show differences between various tissues in a rat. Aberdeen was in a position not only to confirm his findings, but following further work done by Paul Lauterbach, they constructed a small NMR imager and produced the first image of a mouse. This was in March 1974. This demonstrated that the technique could produce images showing body structure, but as it required an hour to produce an image, the mouse had to be killed first. Somewhat of a problem if the technique was to be used clinically. At this point, John took a decision that was to have profound consequences for what was come to be known as magnetic resonance MRI imaging. Rather than continue an incremental approach, gradually building bigger and bigger images, the Aberdeen group would build one capable of whole body human images. With support from the Medical Research Council, John's team constructed what was to be the first whole body clinical MR imager. They were able to reduce imaging time to about 20 minutes, but all attempts to produce three-dimensional images were spoilt by organ motion. Finally, the team came up with what was to prove the breakthrough that MRI needed, a technique which they named spin warp imaging. One of the team members was a keen Star Trek fan. It's several weeks of trial imaging on team members ensued, and on 26th of August 1980, the first patient was imaged, and the images showed not only the known tumours, but others in the spine. John realised that if the intellectual property was to be protected, then patents would need to be taken out. And fortunately, a government agency had been set up to develop intellectual property, and they prepared the patents. Inevitably, the medical device companies tried to break the patents. The resulting court costs ran up costs of £1.5 million, but the patents were successfully defended, and John estimated that during their lifetime, the patents generated £34 million in royalties, which was divided amongst the university and inventors after the legal expenses were paid. John's view was research was not genuinely medical physics unless it could be used routinely to benefit patients. So his next step was to build a second imager dedicated to clinical work. He had hoped to build a machine using more powerful superconducting magnets instead of the resistive ones used in the first machine, but couldn't raise the money from the research funding bodies. Instead, he reached an agreement with a Japanese company, Asahi, which in return for funding would get access to the know-how. At the same time, John set up a company to manufacture the imager. However, it was undercapitalized, and they sold just 3 machines. In comparison, Asahi sold 145 machines before selling the technology to Siemens. Today, the first MR imager is on display in the Sutty Arts Centre on the Forester Hill site, where anyone can view it and the accompanying explanatory video. John's vision of using electron spin resonance was not dead, however. An imaging technology derived from this concept is currently being developed in Aberdeen by Professor David Lurie and his team. But John's energies were not simply directed at research. As head of a university department, he was very much aware of the need to train graduate physicists and engineers in the discipline of medical physics. In 1968, he set up the first master's course in medical physics in the UK. Its success is evidenced by the fact that it's still running after 50 years. I often meet ex-students in different parts of the world, and they all have fond memories of their time in Aberdeen. When the research councils announced that they were funding courses in IT, John quickly produced an MSc in IT in medical physics, followed by ones in medical imaging and in bioengineering. He was never slow to spot an opportunity to develop training in our field. John left a very generous legacy to support the Fiona and John Mallard Trust for Physics and Engineering in Medicine. Its aim is to deliver a memorial lecture which reflects John's interest in engineering, science and medicine, and to provide educational fellowships for study and research in physics and engineering and medicine at the University of Aberdeen. The first memorial lecture, Hitting Tumours with a Hybrid 1.5 Tesla MRI Radiotherapy System, was given in Glasgow earlier in the year. Training graduates to work in medical physics was only part of the story. John was also very active in forming and supporting professional bodies to represent and develop the subject. He was instrumental in the creation of the Professional Body for Medical Physics in the UK, what is now known as the Institute of Physics and Engineering in Medicine, and served as its president. There's sometimes a conflict between engineers working in medicine and physicists, but John was not of that view, and he served as president of the Biological Engineering Society. But he also had an international view of medical physics. He was president of the International Organization for Medical Physics, founder vice president of the European Nuclear Medicine Society. He was also founder president of the European Society for Magnetic Resonance in Medicine and Biology, and the International Union for Physical and Engineering Sciences and Medicine. Now, as is evident from the story of John's career, he had an enormous impact on medical imaging, with many thousands of patients having good cause to be grateful to what John and the many brilliant medical physicists who worked with him achieved. And I'm sure Professor Murray will be better able to put that in the medical context. So not surprisingly, his work was recognized by many honors and prizes. They include the Landau Memorial Plaque of the American Association of Physicists in Medicine, the Academic Enterprise Competition Prize of the British Technology Group, the Royal Society Wellcome Prize and Gold Medal, the George Van Havesey Memorial Lecture Medal, the Royal Society Mullard Award, and the Gold Medal of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. He received the Fellowship of the Institute of Physical Sciences in Medicine, the International Society of Magnetic Resonance in Medicine, and most recently he became the first Fellow of the International Union of Physical and Engineering Sciences in Medicine. He was awarded the OBE and the Queen's Birthday Honours in 1992, the Freedom of the City of Aberdeen in 2004, and the Freedom of his birthplace, Northampton, in 2018. Now, what is very clear from looking back over John's career is his determination to follow his vision despite all the obstacles in his way. He used to have a plaque in his office which read, "Illegitimi non carborundum," don't let the bastards grind you down. Early this morning, we sang John's favourite hymn, "Who Would True Valour See?" Of particular relevance is John Bunyan's phrase, "Whoso beset him round with dismal stories, do but themselves confound, his strength the more is." John was a visionary, not just about medical imaging, but also on how our profession of medical physics should develop. I once asked him whether, if he had his time again, he would still go into medical physics. He said yes, but he felt the future would be in radiotherapy rather than imaging. Now let me finish by quoting the words of one now retired NHS chief executive who worked with him, and he had this to say. "John Mallard was one of the most difficult characters I've ever had to deal with. But that was more than compensated by his brilliance and utter determination to achieve what he knew could be done. My experience of working with him was the highlight of my career, and I am honoured to have known him." Not a bad epitaph.
Thanks very much, Mary-Lee, for help. And thank you, Kat, for the honour of inviting me to take part in this special event. Thank you also to Peter. My name is Alison Murray, and for over 30 years before I retired in 2020, I have been a clinical radiologist. That's a doctor who specialises in the imaging of patients. During much of that, I have been an academic radiologist, and for the last 8 years of my career, I had the honour of succeeding Fiona Gilbert as Professor of Radiology at the University of Aberdeen. Why, you might be wondering, is someone who was at nursery school when Professor John Mallard was appointed in 1965 standing here giving a tribute, and a mere clinician at that? I am here to share with you how patients have reaped the benefits of his brilliance and of his lasting legacy. I have always had enormous respect for medical physicists, and I had my first encounter with Professor Mallard's department in 1979 as a sixth-year pupil at Hazelhead Academy studying then SYS physics, now advanced higher. Suffice to say that those I met were generous with their knowledge, and my wee project was a success. A few years later, I vividly remember seeing, as an undergraduate medical student at the University of Aberdeen, learning about a new imaging technique called magnetic resonance imaging, and being wowed by a brain scan that had never before been possible. This was groundbreaking stuff, and I am sure influenced my subsequent decision to become a radiologist. John Mallard understood that for imaging research to make a difference to patients, it had to be both accessible and capable of imaging the whole body. This was the approach taken for all the imaging developments that he pioneered, including the Aberdeen section scanner, which was an early version of SPECT in nuclear medicine, for positron emission tomography, or PET scanning, and magnetic resonance imaging. Because of his vision, Aberdeen possessed the ability to image patients as soon as a new technology was developed. He also understood the importance of working with a radiologist. Dr. Francis Smith, subsequently Professor Smith, was the lead radiologist in nuclear medicine at the time that MRI was developed. Frank immediately saw the potential of this new imaging modality and was instrumental in bringing patients to the Mark I scanner in the Medical Physics Building and demonstrating that MRI provided new information not seen on other scans. The combination of a medical physicist and a radiologist is a powerful one. The physicist knows how to measure, the radiologist knows what to measure. The huge advantages of MRI over the recently developed computed tomography were threefold. Lack of ionizing radiation or X-rays, a multiplanar capability, and superb soft tissue contrast. Prof. Mallard also knew that, crucially, the next generation of scanner should be located in the hospital where the patients were. I hope you've been to see the Mark I scanner in the Sutty Art Space. If not, I urge you to go and marvel that this Heath Robinson contraption produced such diagnostic results. However, there's no denying that the Mark I scanner does not look clinically appealing for patients. This was remedied with the Mark II scanner, which was both enclosed in fascia to hide the scaly coils, and importantly, located in Aberdeen Royal Infirmary. When I returned to Aberdeen from Glasgow as a radiology senior registrar in 1991, the Mark II scanner was still in use, but soon to be replaced by the first commercial scanner. My first research forays were using new MRI sequences in breast cancer for imaging the lymph glands or nodes in the axilla. A study which the current head of imaging physics for NHS Grampian, Professor Roger Staff, still refers to as the armpit study. John Mallard was a visionary. Peter has described the initial PET setup near Wood End, and then the John Mallard Scottish PET Centre opening in Aberdeen Royal Infirmary in 1998. While on call one weekend, I had our children with me, as was often the case. Our eldest daughter, aged 9 at the time, noticed the PET centre sign. "Mummy, is this where people bring their ducks to be scanned?" she asked. Peter has been modest and omitted to explain that it's not enough to show that a new imaging modality is effective at demonstrating disease. To be adopted by a cash-strapped NHS, it also has to be cost-effective. It was his report to the Health Technology Board of Scotland in 1997 that persuaded the Scottish Government that PET was cost-effective in patients with lung cancer, with some forms of lymphoma, and in recurrent bowel cancer. When patients with lung cancer were imaged with PET, we were often seeing disease spread that was not anticipated, which meant that an expensive operation was not appropriate, both saving patients the unnecessary trauma of surgery and saving the NHS the costs of unnecessary surgery. On the other hand, with lymphoma, we often found that following treatment with chemo and radiotherapy, patients had no evidence of residual disease, despite a residual mass on structural scanning with CT. This both avoided the cost and the side effects of unnecessary treatment. when the Scottish Government decided that the evidence for PET was overwhelming, that a service should be provided through the NHS, Aberdeen was the first place to have a scanner because it had the existing infrastructure, thanks to Professor Mallard's vision and Professor Sharp's subsequent work. With the team in the PET Centre and the NHS nuclear medicine team, at that time ably managed by another fabulous medical physicist trained by John Mallard, Dr. Howard Gemmell, we provided a service for patients from all over Scotland. This sometimes made it a little tricky to explain to patients from Dumfries, let alone Glasgow or Edinburgh, why they had to come to Aberdeen for a scan. In 2006, there were three clinical reasons for a patient to have a PET scan, but the clinicians were keen to use PET for different tumours and for other diseases. Evidence mounted, and by 2013, the Royal College of Radiologists published 14 indications, rising to 26 in the most recent UK guidelines. These include not only cancers, but other diseases such as inflammation of blood vessels or fever of unknown origin. And there are now new tracers to use in things like prostate cancer. The number of PET CT scanners has increased from one in Aberdeen in 2006, when we were imaging 1,000 patients a year from across Scotland, to six, carrying out over 9,000 clinical PET CTs a year. I'm grateful to Professor Staff for these updated figures. The success of MRI as a clinical imaging modality has been phenomenal and cannot be overestimated. Leading the team that developed whole body MRI has left an enduring legacy for patients all over the world. There are over 300,000 MRI scans carried out in Scotland alone every year, with an estimated 75 million MRI scans across the world. Globally, there are about 50,000 MRI machines, most in Japan and the United States. But the story is not over yet. MRI research is alive and well at the University of Aberdeen. Using the Clinical Research 3 Tesla scanner, Gordon Waiter is looking at new ways of imaging Alzheimer's disease, the effects of chemotherapy on the brain, and at changes due to long COVID. A low-field MRI research group has recently relocated from Switzerland to Aberdeen. Lino Brosch and his team continue to work on field cycling MRI, a completely new type of MRI developed by Professor David Lurie, a method where the magnetic field is changed during scanning and gives completely new information. There are exciting clinical projects in stroke with Professor Mary Jo McLeod, in brain tumours, and in imaging the heart. To finish, and I am sure John Mallard would approve, a clinical version of the field cycling MRI scanner is nearly complete within the Aberdeen Biomedical Imaging Centre on the hospital site to demonstrate the value of this new MRI method in patients. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is John Mallard. I was known as Young John as opposed to Father John. But there was no religious significance, I can assure you. I'm going to read a favourite passage of my father. It's from the Shakespearean play Cymbeline, Act 4, Scene 2. It's known as the funeral song. But unlike Fiona, I'm not skilled in the art of singing, so I will say it. Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor the furious winter's rages. Thou thy worldly task hath done, home art gone and ta'en thy wages. Golden lads and girls all must, as chimney sweepers, come to dust. Fear no more the frown of the great, thou art past the tyrant's stroke. Care no more to clothe and eat, to thee the reed is as the oak. The scepter, learning, physic must all follow this and come to dust. Fear no more the lightning flash, nor the old dreaded thunderstone. Fear not slander, censure rash. Thou hast finished joy and moan. All lovers young, all lovers must consign to thee and come to dust. No exorciser harm thee, nor no witchcraft charm thee. Ghost unled forbear thee. Nothing ill come near thee. Quiet consummation have, and renowned be thy grave. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Loving God, you have given us life with all its possibilities and opportunities, and we thank you for the gift of life. Today we thank you that we have gathered to give thanks for the life of Professor John Mallard. We thank you for all that he meant to each of us, for the moments that were deep, special, and personal, for the shared memories which we keep as a source of comfort and continuing thankfulness that are ours to keep, to hold on to, and to enjoy. We especially remember with gratitude his heart for his family, his care, gentleness, and kindness to those around him. We thank you for his leadership, determination, and purpose, his creativity and vision, and for the legacy that he gifted his loved ones and so many others. May we all be inspired by his courage and tenacity for life. As we go from here, may you uplift us and strengthen us with the hope in your promises that love never ends. Amen. Thank you so much to everyone who has contributed so beautifully today from the music and tributes. They have all been so fitting as we have remembered and celebrated with thankfulness a wonderful gentleman, Professor John Mallard. Please stand together now as we sing our final hymn, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder.
Thank you.
so may the peace of God guide your thoughts and guard your hearts. And may the love of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, be with you now and always. Amen.